Okay, I'm going to focus a fair bit on hydrologic response times, which is really one of the key issues in trying to manage groundwater and surface water interactively. So as particularly Ken mentioned, there are several sources of water to a pumping well, shown in the bottom figure there. One is you can either increase recharge or decrease discharge, and those are collectively known as capture. You're essentially capturing water that would have gone to a surface water body, or as most people think about, you can remove water from the system. And the extent to which you do that is really unique depending upon the groundwater system. This is a bit dated in terms of the data, but the same results show today in many of these systems. Essentially, what each of those pie charts shows is the percentage, the amount of water that's coming from recharge, from increased recharge, from decreased discharge, or from decreased storage. So the red you see there is decreased storage, and I think one of the most notable things there is that you see there's really less decreased discharge or decreased storage in most of these systems than most people might think. In fact, recently a couple of USGS scientists, Lenny Konikow and Stan Leake, looked at a large number of models across the United States, and they found that pumping groundwater, about 85% of the water has actually come from capture, and only about 15% from storage decline. So ultimately, the surface water systems in many respects are feeling the effects of the pumping. The other interesting thing about these charts is you see the systems in the west have a cross-hatching on them, and that's increased recharge due to infiltration of irrigation water. So the application of irrigation water can essentially accentuate the rate of the hydrologic system flows and greatly increase recharge over natural levels. As another diagram shows, one of the issues with surface water is that a small amount of pumping and reduction of the water table can actually have a very large effect on the stream. And this simply shows it there for a partially penetrating stream. You can see how the water is going to come off the top, and so it's going to have an effect on that stream flow well before you have any large percentage from the system itself. And so essentially a depletion of a small part of the total volume of groundwater storage can have large effects on surface water. And these can become the limiting factors to development. And I give you three examples there. So the upper San Pedro Basin in Arizona is an area of development, plus has one of the great flyways of the United States. And something like 1 or 2% of the water in storage has been pumped, and there are major concerns about the effects on the surface water flow in the upper San Pedro. The Edwards Aquifer in Texas is a good example of a limestone karst aquifer system. A couple feet of water level decline have major impacts on endangered species. And the third example there is the Republican River Basin, which has gone to the Supreme Court between the states of Colorado, Kansas, and Nebraska. And they pumped maybe 3 to 5% of the total volume of water in the upper Republican Basin. But yet they're in the Supreme Court working over the surface water, effects of surface water issues. Putting this in the context of sustainability, sustainable yield, this is a diagram actually from the Upper San Pedro Partnership. It shows the change in storage over time. And what you see there is a typical situation where you have a depletion period that may go on for decades. Ultimately, the problem manifests itself, usually most easily seen in reduced water levels. And then issues of sustainability come up. And there are really not, there's not an exact equation for sustainability. And I think Thomas Harter's presentation gave a good example of the different options that one can take. You can either cease somewhere between ceasing pumping and coming up with an acceptable new steady state is shown there as a range of options for sustainable use. Okay, so I want to turn finally to the hydrologic time scales is the response time of these systems. And the top of this diagram basically shows sort of our human time scale, and the lower part shows the hydrologic time scale. So the little circles there show the average residence time of different systems. And as you can see, it ranges from biota, very short residence time, up to groundwater, which has, on average, about 1,400 years residence time. About the same, really, as oceans in terms of the water before it returns to the atmosphere, to a surface water body. although that can range dramatically from anywhere from tens of years to tens of thousands of years, or even a million years. At the top, in comparison to that, you know, we have our most groundwater policy horizons have typically been more in the 5 to 20 year time frame, although they're increasingly becoming more 50 year time frame. But that's much greater, of course, than a typical government term. It's one of the issues associated with trying to manage these systems. But if you want to manage groundwater resources sustainable, we need to consider the time scale of the consequences. So let's look at some of those. Again, this diagram shows the fraction of pumping that comes from capture versus storage for a typical system. And what it shows is when you first start pumping a well, shown by the blue line there, all of your water is coming from storage. And that decreases over time for this well pumping or stream. Gradually, you're pumping more and more water that is capture, and that capture includes increased inflow from surface water or decreased outflow, depending on whether the stream is gaining or losing, and also reduced evapotranspiration. And the timing of this depletion depends on the storage and transmissive properties of the aquifer, as well as the distance to the connected surface water features. And notice that time scale there, which is shown in tens of years, can range all to hundreds or thousands or much shorter periods of time, also depending upon the particular system. So for three examples, we'll go to the Colorado Plateau in Arizona, and shown on the lower left there is a Lower Clear Creek, which we'll talk about. I'll go to Paradise Valley in Nevada, and finally end up in Chesapeake Bay. We'll focus also here on the water quality aspects of that, of this time delay in these groundwater surface water systems. So the first example on the Colorado Plateau is shown on the left there as an area of pumping, and the question was, what impact would that have on Clear Creek and Lower and Echelon Creek, Chevron Creek, to the southeast of the area of pumping, about 20 to 25 miles away. This is a modeling study. It's the only way you can really look at the long-term effects of pumping on surface water bodies. And you can see there stream flow capture is shown versus time. So the simulation essentially simulated the withdrawal of water at about 9 CFS, and you can see that's much greater than the scale there of 0.1, 0.2, 0.3, for 50 years, and then the pumps were turned off. And this illustrates one of the points that was made earlier in presentations, is that the maximum stream flow depletion is not when you turn off the pumps, but actually occurs decades later because of the slow transmission, essentially, of the depletion through the system, eventually affecting lower Clear Creek. It's much less, the stream flow capture there, as you can see, is much less than the 9 CFS, which is the good news. It's spread out over time. The bad news is that it's spread out over time, and so somewhere down the pike, the effects will be felt. And if you just don't turn off the well, and everything goes back immediately to the way it was before. Second example shows a very long system, so you can see how long these effects can take. And this is a Paradise Valley. It's up near the Humboldt River drainage area in Nevada, shown there. It's a alluvial system. Most of the recharge occurs actually through those streams, shown as blue lines on the graph there. And again, here's a pie diagram that's showing for a simulation of 300 years where the water would come from to those pumping wells. So a year and a half into pumping, about 80% of the water would be coming from storage and 20% from a reduction in evapotranspiration. But as you can see, over time, the amount coming from storage decreases and the amount coming from capture, which are the other three categories, is increasing. At first, most of the water is coming from a reduction in evapotranspiration, and then it actually shifts over, as shown in the light blue there, to an increased inflow from Humboldt River Valley and, to a lesser extent, decreased outflow to the Humboldt River Valley. So essentially, you're taking water from the Humboldt River Valley eventually through this long period of pumping, and it's taking a long time, and the system never really actually comes back to equilibrium in this particular scenario. So these systems can take very short periods of time, literally days, weeks, or they can take hundreds of years to respond to pumping. Finally, an area of particular interest relative to nitrate is the Chesapeake Bay. So nitrate is a nutrient, and there's a lot of concerns about nutrients, both nitrate and phosphorus, that flow into the bay. The nitrate is the principal one coming from groundwater. It turns out that a lot of nitrate in the bay actually comes from groundwater discharge to streams that flow into the bay. So we're going to look at some results from the Delmarva Peninsula, which is essentially the right-hand side of the map there, just shown with Delaware and parts of Maryland, a little bit of Virginia. This study was done by Ward Sanford from USGS, and on the left-hand side shows the base flow age distribution. So let me back up a quick second. The issue is that if you start to apply best management practices in the Chesapeake Bay watershed, for example, reductions in fertilizer, planting winter cover crops, etc., at what point will you begin to see the effects of those management practices on improved water quality in the bay and improved groundwater discharge to the bay? And so one of the issues is, how long does it take for water carrying the nitrate to flow through the groundwater system to the bay? And that's where, on the left-hand side, you can see a pie diagram, and you can see that more than one quarter of the water base flow discharge to streams into Chesapeake Bay is greater than 50 years. So that's a clue right there that it's going to take a while for any kind of management practice that you put in place in Chesapeake Bay watershed to actually have an effect on nitrate in the bay. So essentially, you have to be patient. The graph on the right shows, the dark line there shows the nitrogen load to the bay in thousands of metric tons. So if you do nothing, by the year 2050, it's projected that there will be about 7,000 tons per year flowing in of nitrate, nitrogen flowing into Chesapeake Bay. The current goal, the TMDL, the total maximum daily load target, is to reduce the current load to the bay, which is somewhere around 6,500 or so, down by 25% to 5,000 tons per year, shown there by the dashed line. So the different color lines show the effects of different levels of reduction and the time it takes for those to be affected on the bay. So if you have a 13% load reduction, you can essentially bring the system into somewhat steady state at current levels. If you have a 40% reduction, then you gradually get to back down to the 5,000 level, but essentially that doesn't occur until 2050. It takes 100% load reduction to get down there even by 2020. So it gets through these kind of scenarios, you can start to see how one might expect it to play out if you reduce nitrogen loads to the bay. This has a lot of implications in terms of how you monitor the system, and again, what your expectations might be. So with that, I think we now can turn to the question period.